the coach a blue and white and kind of goldish colored team?
Yeah, that's also in the state of Michigan, really close to Canada.
Starts with W and ends with hitting.
Yep.
Tech Hockey Guide presents the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the CCHA with your host, Tim Brown, Rob Gilreath, Dustin Lindstrom, and Matt Cavender.
Welcome to episode 29 of season 3 of the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, presented by Tech Hockey Guide. I'm Tim Brown, your host, and I'm joined this week by Dustin Lindstrom.
Hey, everyone.
And Rob Gilreath.
Hey, guys.
Before we get into the podcast, I'd like to thank our two newest patrons, Brett Libby and Robert Carnahan. Thanks for joining the Black Level guys. And also Lucas Pipenhagen, who upgraded his plan recently to the $5 level. I think we may have had one other one, and I feel bad for forgetting. But thank you guys for helping us out and supporting us. We decided to go without a guest this week to wrap up the season. I haven't really prepared. So what do you guys want to talk about this week?
Well, I have a little bit of a list that I came up with. So I figure we can do a little bit of a brief overview of the Frozen Four. I think we all watched that. Probably a lot of our listeners watched it. Some other news from the last week. I'd like to touch on the Hockey East ESPN Plus streaming news. Hallinen made the All-America team. Hobie Baker for Dryden McKay. Maybe touch on the portal and potential recruits, and then some coaching news from some other Michigan in-state teams.
Yeah, not the one we expected to hear from first.
Yeah,
but we're not going to hear, I don't know. I don't think you're going to hear anything on the other one for 10, 12 days at the most.
No, I know.
Yeah, that's probably true. That's probably true.
I think they're going to take it right to the wire on that one, honestly.
I agree. And then the last topic that I had on my list is to just have a little bit of a discussion of new Division I teams and this ever lengthening list of independent teams that are going to be playing D1 hockey and what that means for potential conference shakeups.
All right. That sounds like a plan. Let's do the thank you notes and have a brief note from our sponsors, and we'll be back to chat about, I guess we'll start with the Frozen Four.
Fibke Dental is a general dentistry practice located in downtown Rhinelander, Wisconsin, home of the Hodag. Look online at FibkeDental.com or find them on Facebook. They do pain-free dentistry for kids, adults, people that went to great schools, and people that ended up at Northern Michigan. Stop in and say hi between 8 and 5 and tell them THG sent you. That is F-I-E-B-K-E Dental.com.
Do you work in manufacturing, product design, or product development? Is your business trying to improve efficiency while also producing at scale? Livonia Technical Services can help. They provide world-class quality improvement training and consulting for failure modes and effect analysis, product development, and cost reduction. All things that could help Northern Michigan assemble a competent defense. If you think your business could use a prevention mindset and reduce manufacturing costs, a partnership with Livonia Technical Services might be right for you. Check them out at livoniatech.net. That's LIVONIA tech.net.
Hey, it's Kaylee Cuoco for Priceline. Ready to go to your happy place for a happy price? Well, why didn't you say so? Just download the Priceline app right now and save up to 60% on hotels. So whether it's Cousin Kevin's Kazoo concert in Kansas City, go Kevin, or Becky's Bachelorette Bash in Bermuda, you never have to miss a trip ever again. So download the Priceline app today. Your savings are waiting.
Go to your happy place for a happy price. Go to your happy price, Priceline.
All right, welcome back. Dustin, you watched The Frozen Four. What'd you think?
Well, it went almost exactly how I thought it was going to, except for that third period on Saturday night. I mean, I think we all wanted Mankato to win. right?
I don't think you can have a more heartbreaking letdown than the last 20 minutes of Hockey of the Year we got to watch this year.
Yeah.
I saw a lot of complaints about like the distraction that was the Hobie ceremony.
Yeah.
And I just don't agree. Like,
no, me either.
You really think Dryden McKay wants to accept that award after he loses the national championship game?
Right.
I think they do it fine the way they do it. But yeah,
I think that's the way it needs to be.
Yeah. I feel really bad that Minnesota State basically decided to play their worst period of hockey for their last period of hockey of the season. That just sucked.
To me, it looked like Mankato was cruising and they gave up that goal in the third. And it's almost like I don't know if it was after the first goal or after that, or after the second goal where they went down one, but they kind of panicked. Like, and I don't know why, because it's not like they haven't been down a goal. It's not like they haven't been tied with good teams. It's almost like the weight of the moment kind of got to them, and I didn't expect it to.
Yeah, I don't know. It also kind of felt like they looked tired, didn't it? Which I found odd, because I've never seen them tired before. But they looked tired in that third period.
Yeah.
Which I found odd, between the fact that I never felt that way in either Tech series.
Also just been the fact that Denver picked it up to what Denver should have been doing the whole game, right?
Yeah.
Denver got outworked for 40 minutes straight. Mankato was forechecking hard, was in their face on any time they tried to do any of their anytime they tried to break out. The pressure was super hard, and Denver just looked – Denver looked shell-shocked for 40 minutes and wasn't able to do anything. And then all of a sudden they went, oh, yeah, we're one of the best teams in college hockey. We know how to do this stuff. And it completely flipped the game around.
But it almost I think they were like that because Mankato was playing their game. And in the right. third period, you started to see breakdowns that you don't normally see from Mankato. Like, there was a couple very uncharacteristic turnovers. If I remember right, I don't know if they even led to goals, but they led to chances, and it just Mankato wasn't playing like they normally do. I don't know. I don't know how to explain it, but it was kind of shocking and disappointing at the same time, right? I mean,
yeah, and I'm just put up Instats here, so it's not like all the skaters had like 12 minutes at least for the forwards, like not McNeely, Borchert, Fury and Smith all had like 17-18 minutes. Naprovnik, Soder, Sandelin were above 16. Like, it's pretty even. It's not like there's like a big drop off that I would have expected, whereas like the fourth line for Denver had 9 minutes or less for Webster, King, and Ozar, and then the extra skater Edwards had 44 seconds in the whole game. So, yeah, Mankato rolled four lines. Denver didn't really. And
Mankato should have been the more fresh team.
Yeah.
It's hard to explain. I don't know.
Yeah, and the funny part is, I shout out to Gina for winning our bracket challenge. She got, I think, everything right but two of the first round games. I know in my bracket, I had everything right except for any game that Michigan Tech would have played in. I had them losing to Mankato.
Yeah, I'll just look at mine and see what mine looked like. But I think I only missed three games total.
But, that was weird. And, you know, you got to feel bad for the Mankato fans. The other problem, too, is it really shouldn't have been a one-goal game going into the third period. Like, no, Mankato played well enough to be up more than 1-0 at that point. Because you got what here? Not a whole lot, actually. A lot of perimeter shots. That doesn't seem normal for them. Just kind of lost as to what happened there. But, you know, and Minnesota State loses a ton. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. But yeah, pretty much it went the way we all thought it was going to go till the last period.
Mm-hmm. I think that's, I think it's, we already mentioned it, but it's a good kind of transition into, you know, Dryden McKay finally got his big national award. I think we all agree that it was very well deserved. He won the Hobie, but not the Richter. And I think everybody's trying to figure out exactly how that works. But
well, I tweeted out and a lot of people got upset at me, but like I tweeted out that just the Hobie hat trick compared to other things was very confusing. And Ben Myers was second team All-American in the West, according to the American Hockey Coaches Association. Dryden McKay didn't win the Goalie of the Year by the Richter Award. I think pretty much every major news outlet, though, had him on their first team All-American. The American Hockey Coaches Association did, but they also had Devin Levi on the East team. Mm-hmm. I think well, USHO I mean,
Devin Levi and Dryden McKay were the two best goalies in the country. So
no, I agree, but I do have a sense. So the one thing that was pointed out to me by Adam Wooden is the voting happens at a different time. The voting for Richter happens before the regionals. The voting for the Hobie happens after the final voting. So the three finalists for the Richter were determined at whatever point that was, and I'm pretty sure it was Parrots, Levi, and McKay. And I can see why, if you look at them before the regional weekend, that vote could have gotten divided pretty evenly three ways, and Levi just came out ahead. But after regional weekend, with what McKay did against Notre Dame and whoever, why can't I think Harvard?
Harvard
versus what Parrots did against in his two games, which were not good at all. Yeah. And then Levi didn't do anything special. And you can see why he would come out on top there afterwards, right? Like, although I don't remember if the hat trick was already decided by then. I don't remember when that happens or if they announced the hat trick.
I think if I remember right, it was announced after regional weekend.
Yeah, so I think they already know who won, and they just announced who the top three vote getters are. So I can see why that happens, but I kind of feel like that needs to change. Like that voting should happen at the same time, even if it's different groups of people. But like, and I also think it shows how even the very top of everything was this year. Because then my third point was that, you know, Bobby Brink was the other Hobie hat trick guy, and there are 50 some guys in the country that had more goals than him. Like, now granted, that's not the only thing, but my point, and a lot of Denver people hated me for saying that, but I'm like, usually the guy that like doesn't score much but puts up a bunch of points is not the guy that wins Hobie.
Unless they're a super high scoring defenseman with a massive amount of assists, that the guys that's like different. That.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. But if Bobby Brink put up the same line from the blue line, I get it. I do. 14 goals and 50 some points or whatever it was. Like, yeah, that makes sense. But not from a forward. Now, granted, the difference between him and some of the other guys that come to mind is he played on a team that was a top seed and they made it to the Frozen Four. But like, he was really good, but like, how do you pick him over, what was it, Gutman, I think?
Yeah, but honestly, and isn't the biggest issue, like when you start talking about breaking down goals and assists, how is it that somebody like Ethan Frank from Western Michigan didn't even make the top 10?
Yeah.
That's insane.
There was a lot of complaining about that, but I think part of that is the nature of how the voting is done to determine the top 10. The coaches get six votes. They each vote their top three in the country and their top three in the conference. And if, I don't know, like,
In no reality does it make sense that the leading goal scorer in the country that plays in the unanimous best conference in the country isn't one of the top 10 players in the country.
Yeah, and it wasn't like he's where is it here? He still had 39 points, but maybe that's part of it, is he just didn't have the assists. But then, like, well,
26 goals. I mean,
I know.
Yeah, it makes no sense to me.
But I think that's part of the whole problem, Dustin, was I think it, especially in the NCHC, that there must have been enough division of like who, like he didn't. I don't know. I know there's a lot of complaints that he wasn't up there, but I do think there's, I don't even remember, like how many, there were three guys from CCHA, right?
Hallinan in the top 10, you mean?
Yeah.
Hallinan, Smith, McKay, right?
Yeah. I think part, like, I know a lot of people don't agree with me, but I think it, with the Richter Award existing, I think it's time that the Hobie become a skater award. Because I do think part of the reason that you didn't get Ethan Frank is because you had Parrots, Levi, and McKay. And it's hard to argue that those guys aren't three of the best players in the country.
Yeah, I guess I can see the argument on both sides of that. And if they decided to change it so the Hobie is a skater-only award, I wouldn't have an issue with that. But I also don't have a problem keeping it the same as it is.
And you do have a sense, like, I wouldn't be surprised if part of the reason McKay won was sort of a career achievement award, where he didn't win the goalie of the year, but it's hard to say he wasn't the best goalie over the last 4 years, period.
Yeah, and I don't have a problem with that either, because he's been absolutely incredible for the better part of 4 years, and maybe the best goalie ever, or second best behind Ryan Miller in college hockey. Like,
yeah,
the kid deserves some recognition.
So I've heard this a lot, but how, I've heard this a lot where, like, people have put Devin Levi on a pedestal because of how many shots he's faced. Part of me has always said that, like, I think it's a lot easier to have a crazy good save percentage when you're facing a decent amount of shots versus a guy like McKay having to keep focus, seeing five shots a period. Like, that's not easy.
Yeah, that's true.
Now, granted, most of those shots aren't like the one that led to the what was it, the tic-tac-toe goal that the Gophers got to get ahead 1-0?
Well, I mean, I don't think there's been a goalie that's ever been born that would have stopped that goal.
Yeah, no. That back-and-forth passing was wonderful.
But that's what I mean. Like, but that was also a very non-typical Mankato play. Like, that was a bad turnover. That was a very Michigan Tech NCAA tournament moment right there, right? Like,
yeah. Yeah, exactly.
But, yeah, I don't know. That was, yeah, I think it's great that he won it. I think it's, you know, terrible, especially for some of our close friends, Dustin, that Mankato didn't finish the job off. And I also think it's, you know, it's sad for the conference that it, that Mankato wasn't able to finish, even if most of the country looks at it as Mankato and everybody else, right? I think it'd still be good. I think it would have still been, excuse me, I think it would have been really good for the conference to, like, have that trophy to put on the list of things they accomplished in year one.
For sure. That would be a fantastic way to wrap up the first year. No doubt.
So, yeah, I I mean, it's a good thing anyway that Minnesota State made the championship game, because that's the first time the conference Michigan Tech has been in has made the tournament since the reshuffling started. So yeah, all in all, it was a pretty good tournament and fun to watch. I don't know about your perspective, Dustin. Did you watch much of the regionals?
I watched quite a bit. Yeah.
How did you like the format as a person staying home? The change to the off days and...
Oh, I liked it a lot. The fact that you could watch every single game the first 2 days.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't switching back and forth. It wasn't trying to figure out, well, what's games on ESPN3, or which I guess is probably not ESPN Plus.
Yeah.
It was just put it on the channel. Game after game after game after game.
Yeah. Speaking of which, ESPN, what the hell are you doing moving the overtime to ESPNU for a, what was it, like the pregame show for the baseball game?
And it wouldn't be bad if their streaming service didn't link channels to streams.
Yeah.
If they linked content to streams, it would be so much better.
But the other problem was, Rob, is the game was supposed to be on ESPN2. And if you had a package that had ESPN2 but didn't have ESPNU, you didn't get to watch overtime.
Right.
And that's not how it should be. That was their choice.
Yeah.
Like, their choice to move that should not block you from watching because you have one channel and not the other. That was a load of crap. Thankfully, my access did not prevent me from watching, but
I didn't experience that because I had no interest in watching a game between Denver and Michigan when I didn't want either team to win.
Yeah. I was like, I don't even remember what I said in Discord, but I think it was something like, leave it to Mel to make me root for Denver.
Right, exactly. I mean, I would have been rooting for Denver, but God, I hate Denver too.
Yeah. So, yeah, like I liked it better too, Rob. What did you think from traveling?
I think if they tick it back a day, then it would be better. One day backwards.
At least one, if not two.
Yeah, Thursday be the starting day is rough.
I think Saturday, Sunday should be the 4-game days and the championship should be Monday, Tuesday.
I wouldn't mind that.
Because you still have Tuesday to the following Thursday for Frozen Four travel, but that gives us fans more time to make plans to get to Denver or wherever. Like, that's the tough part is, I mean, look what happened with Matt and his guys. Like, the flights went up too fast. And I mean, you're going to have that happen anyway, but
I think that's a reasonable request.
I also think
it's not like they're going to listen, but
no. And I also think the nice thing that I could see happening more is I think it would be really, really smart for the West to try and work together to have like Fargo and Sioux Falls the same year. Because I'll go to all of them. It's only a couple hours back and forth, right? Like, I'm not going to just stay in Fargo. Like, that might piss off, I guess, the local people that we're not, like, staying in their establishments all the time. But, like,
you're still renting a hotel, right?
Yeah, I'm still renting it somewhere, wherever the games were probably the first day. But, like,
you're probably the minority in that, though, Tim. The majority of the people that are going there are going to stay in Fargo, and they're just going to drink and go out to eat on that off day.
Because
they don't care about going to Sioux Falls. Like, the percentage of people that are going to do what you're doing is pretty small.
I agree with that. I know Rob and I talked about doing it if we went out east, but But I don't think the West regionals are ever going to be close enough to do that, because I just don't think they're going to line up that way. But I think that could be something that could be helpful. But I also have the advantage of I probably don't have to pay for tickets to all of them. I can get a press pass to one of them, you know, like, and I don't have a whole lot of interest in going to do like spending all that money to drive out to Sioux Falls and Fargo if Tech isn't involved at all. I might, but with how high ticket prices are, probably not. But I will say this, Loveland is like the perfect venue.
Yeah.
It's the right size.
For the amount of people that kind of complained about, you know, Loveland being a boring place, I don't know what they're complaining about.
Yeah. Well, we couldn't ask for better weather. I mean, yeah, I saw the updates of what it was like back in Minnesota, and it was what, like freezing rain and snow and rain and
right
25 to 40 degrees the whole time we were gone, and we were in shorts the whole time pretty much.
Yep.
It was quite pleasant. Gorgeous weather. Found a lot of great restaurants. I would totally go back. That was a lot of fun.
Beer was good. I'm drinking one of them right now.
Yeah.
Only lost one of them on the trip back home in the suitcase that, you know, decided to explode and pop on me.
Yeah.
There was a lot of good stuff to do out there.
My pickled beans made it just fine. The jelly did too. It was a good trip. I had a blast.
I really enjoyed it.
I know I'll have to get my daughter out there sometime so she can appreciate the mountains more than what it looks like on a 7-inch screen.
Well, and it's also, I didn't realize the severe amount of dogs out there. That didn't make me sad.
No, it was kind of cool.
They were everywhere.
Let's get into some portal stuff. Dustin, what did you want to talk about on the portal?
Well, I guess mostly just kind of trends that I've seen. Like, there's a lot of players that I didn't expect, like names I didn't expect to see show up in the portal that did.
Like Sillinger?
Sillinger is one. There were a couple guys from Michigan that I didn't think would show up there. Maybe another topic coming up, but maybe a sign of something to come. But
well, I do think the one thing you have to remember is super seniors scholarships count this coming season.
Yeah, but I guess I didn't look to see if the ones from Michigan are super seniors.
No, Lambert and Moyle are both seniors.
Okay. Like
graduating seniors.
I thought there's one more, though.
I don't know. Those two just came up today, so.
I don't know. I'll have to look. I got to look and see.
They're the only two Michigan guys on my Gopher Puck Live one.
Okay. Well, I just go kind of off of whatever Schlossman tweets about daily.
Yeah.
But guys from Minnesota, too.
Definitely one that I would think Michigan Tech would be interested in, the defenseman.
And I could see Brinkman. Tech being interested in a couple of super seniors from Michigan, too.
Yeah. I don't know what to think of what Joe will do. But as far as the portal goes, I guess the other interesting thing is Michigan Tech. When we last talked on the podcast, we knew about five players in the portal. The fifth one was Caden Bailey. Of the six or of the five guys in the portal, two of them have announced where they're going. Eric Goetz is transferring to Vermont. And Grant Doctor is transferring to St. Thomas. I don't know where Vermont is getting their hockey street cred, but they're doing a pretty darn good job of picking up kids from Minnesota now, aren't they?
Yeah, well, they got the two best players, high school players in the state.
Yeah, committed. Max Strand and then the kid from Prior Lake, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it said Max Strand, according to Lucas Pipenhagen, who pays for Neutral Zone, they have him listed as coming in next year, but they have the kids from Prior Lake going to juniors for a year.
I would have expected both of them to go to juniors, but maybe Strand goes in right away.
Who knows what actually happens, and maybe something like some of the other grad transfers, because I don't think he's the only one that they've gotten either, is he? Let me look here again. Not that that part gets updated all that fast, but no, I guess he's the only one.
I think it might be worth mentioning that Arizona State seems to be kind of pulling in some pretty big talent in the portal.
Yeah, they've gotten, four players so far?
A couple guys from Northeastern and Sillinger.
And then three guys from Northeastern, I guess. Two forwards and a goalie. all transferred there. Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, I guess it's not that surprising that a kid like a bunch of kids would want to go play in Arizona if given the opportunity now.
Yeah, that's not surprising.
I still find it odd that Sillinger is in the portal.
Maybe it's just like he wanted to play with his brother, and now his brother's gone, and he doesn't see much of a reason to stay or something.
And didn't somebody on Discord say something about like his mom is in Tempe or something?
I don't remember that seeing that, but that could be. Is he going to Arizona State? Is there not known?
Yeah.
He is, okay.
Yeah. So yeah, I know I've seen some stuff about like how dumb the portal is, and honestly, I think it's fine. Like, it's not like there's a ton of players. I mean, there's a ton of players in there, but what is it, like 4 per school, and most of them are 1 year left, and a lot of that is because of the extra year that the portal has granted. And then last year, it wasn't as big a deal because any super senior last year, their scholarship didn't count towards the 18 limit. Now going forward, they do count, and they've always counted on players that transferred.
Yeah, I think there's going to be a lot of players that are in the portal that don't find teams.
But that's part of this. Part of the problem with all of this, too, is like, this is really the first year that we have like a list, right? Like a legit list, like the whole thing.
Dumping the whole thing, yeah.
And I do like, how is this really any different than like when Jamie Russell came in and like 4 or 5 guys didn't stay? You know what I mean? Like, and those guys, a lot of them went D3. Now at least they have a chance to go play at St. Thomas or somewhere, right? Like, and not sit out. And I don't think that's as big a problem, but like I don't know. I mean, St. Thomas has what, 7 guys in the portal, it looks like. But I guess I think it's just the nature of things where like half of this is going to be guys choosing to move on, and how many of these guys are in the portal because the coach told them they don't have a place anymore? We don't know that.
Right. Probably quite a few of them.
Yeah. But I like, there's little doubt that some of these guys are in the portal because the guy like Joe Sean can't guarantee them playing time and they think they deserve it. And that's still part of the game. They have, I know a lot of people think you've made the commitment. I know Rob, you don't like it really at all, but like I don't know, like players have a right to change their minds.
My opinion of it is,
I don't have a problem.
The portal almost seems like it's a half measure, right? It's this way for them to change teams whenever they want and not honor a commitment, but it's a commitment that is kind of one-sided and isn't firm. I mean, it's a very imperfect system. I'm almost at the point where I think, at the time of commitment, in college hockey, they're not kids. It's all adults that are, by the time they come into the school, with maybe a very few exceptions. If it's a player that you want to sign up for 1 year, the school commits to scholarship for 1 year. It's almost like a professional contract.
But they all are 1 year.
But make it so you can have, if you want them to stay longer, get them to sign a 3-year. Then they're locked in for 3 years, or locked in for 4 years, or locked in for 2 years. Make it an option.
I get what you're saying.
A one, two, three, or four year scholarship offer.
But why? Why should Grant Doctor have to stay if he thinks he deserves more playing time, no matter how convoluted that may or may not be?
The biggest problem I have is you have these guys that are using programs as springboards or trying to at times, right? I couldn't get in somewhere else, but I get here and I show, and then someone comes and poaches.
But I don't see that happening a ton. Do you? I mean, I don't like the way North Dakota's using it, but that's North Dakota. I don't see a lot of other stuff like that.
North Dakota's also not getting players that are using it as a springboard. They're getting grad transfer type players to come in for 1 year.
I have no problem with grad transfers. That's fine. You've done your degree. You got your degree.
Those are the players that North Dakota got last year.
The 1 year left
to come in for 1 year.
Yeah, I guess. But I don't know. Like, so as a Bemidji fan, like, they went and got a kid from Air Force, right? Wasn't it?
No, they got Jackson Judding from Colorado College.
No, they got him too. There's two guys they got. They got they got Lincoln Hatton from Army.
Getting out before the big time commitment.
I guess so. But like, so they lose Lucas Sillinger, but they get Lincoln Hatton and Jackson Judding. Like, what? I don't know. So far, it doesn't seem that it's as lopsided as maybe we thought it would be. Right?
And I also do want to reserve judgment a little bit too, until all of the COVID extra year stuff pans out too.
And that's part of the problem in all of
this. Yeah, there's a big ass log jam.
Yeah, there's 228 guys in the portal, and I think 100 some of them are fifth year seniors. And I do think the one thing that I don't like about the portal is But I can't blame them because it is what it is. But like, the goalie shuffling is just weird to some extent, right? Like, I don't know. But we've taken advantage of it too, to some extent, over the years of trying to like fill that hole that way. And like, I do like the portal from the fact that like, it's a lot easier for Michigan Tech now to fix an unbalanced class. Right, that's basically impossible.
It is for everybody.
What I mean. Yeah, like I think that's a good thing that it's easier to fix unbalanced classes and get back to like, so Michigan Tech can bring in a couple grad transfers this year instead of having 15 freshmen, kind of thing.
Well, one of the nice things about college hockey historically has been kind of that shuffling and parity of schools, right?
Yeah,
you have a school that's cyclical or may not necessarily be able to fully do that reload. You have ebbs and flows, right?
Yeah.
Is leveling that off a desirable thing, right? That's part of being a college hockey coach, is managing that. And that's going to kind of go away, I think, a little bit. Or it's just managed differently, right?
Yeah, but that advantage also comes from like, part of that advantage is also the fact that you're, well, I guess it all depends on what happens at schools like, you know, Michigan and North Dakota and Minnesota more long term on how they handle losing guys early. Did they just keep bringing in more and more young guys, or are they going to replace those guys with sophomores?
Yeah, what's Michigan going to do this year when they've lost, you know, five or six guys going pro? How are they reloading next year? Are they grabbing, you know, transfer folks or not?
You're gonna have to ask a new coach.
Yeah, we can talk about that. So I think that's enough portal talk anyway. So I guess the biggest news in the last couple of days is that on the day we're recording here, it was today, right? This morning.
Yeah.
That Danton Cole and Michigan State have decided to part ways, and Michigan State is now looking for a coach. I know I saw some stuff, and Rob even alluded to this either before we started or shortly after we did, that it was kind of surprising to hear this news before we heard anything about Mel Pearson, since It is April 12th at 9:02 p.m. Central Time, and we still haven't heard whether or not he's getting a new contract, and his contract expires in, what, 12 days? No, 18 days?
So in 18 days, he can sign with Michigan State?
Yep, exactly. That was the big joke, because... Doesn't he seem like the kind of guy that spitefully would actually do that?
Absolutely, he would.
Like, no matter how much of a Michigan man he was until all this happened, like, I could totally see him going to Michigan State just to, like, rub it in their face that he can still coach and all of the whatever they came up with was BS. I don't know what to think of that whole situation, because I don't understand how not re-signing him would allow them to, like, seal the investigation. That doesn't make sense to me. Like, are you telling me that we can't, at the very least, that we couldn't have a GoFundMe to get the money to have all the records released if we have to pay for them, like we would for that other request we made that ended up being, what, $600? But I would gladly pay $600 to see the investigation results. And I can't believe that they would be allowed to seal that just because he's no longer with the university.
It's still a public university. It's still subject to a Freedom of Information Act request, right?
Yeah, but there are things that you are not allowed to get via that. But I don't understand how an investigation into his conduct would ever be protected.
Yeah, I don't
that
see
just
how
seems like you're setting yourself up for problems in the future. So I don't understand. Like, somebody made the point that it's probably that they don't have to make it public, but a media outlet or a Freedom of Information request would still have to be fulfilled if requested. It's just with it, like, I don't know. And I find it hard to believe that whatever he did would rise to the level of not signing him again, but not rise to the level of more. Like, that line seems very narrow to me. Like, either Michigan's in trouble for what he did, or they're not, and they bring him back. And it's all a matter of what they can figure out in the next 18 days, whether or not they re-sign him, right? Because I don't know.
There's multiple allegations, aren't there?
I believe so. So it's not like it's one thing. But yeah, I thought there was multiple allegations, and then you add on top of it the stuff that we found, but that's peanuts compared to what they're investigating right now. But it's going to be an interesting couple of weeks just waiting to see what comes of this. And who knows when you guys will actually hear this. Maybe it'll be figured out by then, but whatever. Because I don't know when I'm going to get to editing this, since we're recording on a Tuesday instead of our normal Monday. But yeah, and then so basically it's what him. So we've got the question of what's going on at head coach at Michigan. We know that Michigan State's looking. We know one guy that's going to apply for that job for sure.
The coach of blue and white and kind of goldish colored team.
Yeah, that's also in the state of Michigan, really close to Canada.
Yeah.
Starts with W and ends with Hitton.
Yep.
Yeah, that would
I can pretty much guarantee you that he's applying to that job. Yeah. Maybe he'll actually get it this time.
Is he applying to that job, or is he just resending a resume? Yeah. That was already written. I would like this job when Denton Cole got hired. I would like this job. You know, the cover letter just has a couple of dates updated, and that's it.
Plus, made NCAA tournament.
Yeah.
Right. And was won. More successful over the last 5 years than your previous hire.
Yeah. I don't know how he'd do in the Big Ten. That'd be quite the...
It'd be a different style, that's for sure.
Yeah. Be interesting. What else was on your list there, Dustin?
Oh, just a discussion on the fact that we...
Oh, let's start with the Hockey East stuff.
Oh, yeah, we can talk about that.
Yeah.
So Hockey East made an announcement along with ESPN that all Hockey East broadcasts, or I guess I shouldn't say all, but Hockey East streaming partner is going to be ESPN Plus now. And that brings two, I believe, right? Just ECAC and Hockey East now are going to be on ESPN Plus.
which AI makes some security. Sense because of their proximity to Bristol. And the Ivy League in hockey.
Atlantic Hockey is the only Eastern holdout from ESPN now.
Are we surprised by that?
No, I don't know what they do for streaming anyways, to be honest.
They're on Flow, I thought.
They're on Flow.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I've watched some of those games. I knew that.
Yeah, they're on Flow. Yeah, so now we only need 1, 2, 3, 4 different streaming services to watch all the games or most of the games. Yeah, what was it? There's going to be 50-some games on NESN yet, and then a handful on one of the ESPN networks, and then the rest are on ESPN Plus, I guess. I would love a deal like that for the CCHA, but we have to wait at least 2 more years for that. Hopefully, whenever the Flow Hockey deal sunsets, that we have told Don Lucia and Dominic enough times what we want.
The biggest thing for me is just not having to pay for so many different sources or not having to scramble and figure it out. That aggregator that ESPN is well at doing gives you so many different leagues on there. It'd just be so much better to see that that way.
I mean, there's already 2 NCAA leagues on there and the NHL. Yep. And that's enough reason already to be like, this would be a good spot to be for a league because it's already becoming a destination for hockey watching.
You talk about, like, Brandon made the right point that, like, one of the benefits of being on a thing like ESPN Plus is you have a better shot at a casual fan picking your game because it's on. And so let's say some kid finds out that Michigan Tech is interested in them, right? They can actually pull up ESPN Plus for what, $3 a month if they don't have it already and watch a game then. Versus dropping, what is it, $30 a month to pay by the month for Flow? They're not going to do that, but they probably already have ESPN Plus because a lot of families have the Disney bundle to have the Disney stuff, the Marvel stuff, and all that. So it just makes sense to be on ESPN Plus from an exposure standpoint. The only other thing that I've said is if you're going to stay on Flow, you need to find a way to get Flow to agree to like a free game of the week type thing where like, go use this code and you can watch this game for free kind of thing. So that you get that like game of the week exposure without having the commitment of paying for it. And you just kind of go around the league and play in, you know, have a game in different barn each week and try and have, you know, no teams get repeated more than a couple times. But I think that's the way to go.
Yeah, I do too. I really think that it just makes sense, right?
Yeah.
And as long as it's not, and this is something that a lot of people don't seem to understand. As long as it's not TV produced by them, the platform is fine. It's only when it's TV produced and it's jumping channels is it stupid. The regular streaming from ESPN Plus is fantastic and works very well.
Yeah, the one game that several games I watched from ECAC,
yeah,
was just awful. But it wasn't an ESPN.
That's Plus not their issue. Fault, though. No,
it was whatever. I don't know if it was Quinnipiac and Clarkson. I think
so. It's like when we can.
Well, that, one of them they was, had a lot of problems. That was that the ECAC tournament.
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah, they had a lot of problems with the feed from. Was that from Herb Brooks Arena or whatever in Lake Placid? Isn't that where they play yet?
That's where they play.
Yeah, I believe one of them.
Yeah. It was like the problems that I had. It was like it was the announcers either didn't understand that when like they shouldn't be screaming when there's a goal because it like was so loud that like was crackling like in the microphone. Sure, sure.
Yeah. So they were having clipping issues. Gotcha.
Yeah. And then
Tim, our budding audio engineer.
Yeah. The The production value just was poor, but it was an arena issue. It wasn't an ESPN Plus issue.
Right.
Yeah, that's fair.
And ESPN Plus isn't going to impact that at all.
All right, now let's get into the new D1 teams. Dustin, you want to talk about the ever-growing number of independents that we have?
So I think for next year, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think we have two new teams next year, or is it three? Lindenwood for sure and Stonehill, right?
I think so. Sure. And then Augustana is the year after, right?
I think Augustana is 2023.
We lost Rob. His power went out.
Oh, no.
And then what else do we have coming up?
So the other teams that I have that are kind of like in this weird limbo of being independent, looking for conference, whatever, Huntsville, which we talked a little bit about before we started recording, and we can get back to that. Anchorage, which it seems like they're back for next year.
Yeah, they've been active in the portal, so it seems like they have to be planning on coming back. I have no idea what their schedule is, but...
Well, I saw that they're on Arizona State's schedule for next year when Arizona State released their schedule.
Okay.
Fairbanks, they were an independent this year. They played pretty decent. They were respectable in pairwise as an independent. Long Island will be an independent again. Arizona State, independent again, with a new arena opening. And then...
Which we know the dates on when we will be there, January 6th and 7th for the Desert Hockey Classic, or and whatever it's called now. So
the question that you asked Joe about the other teams there, you were right. Close. It is
BU. I was close. It was BU and Air Force. I had BU and Army.
Ah, okay.
I had the wrong service academy, but that's still cool. We get to possibly play a Saratori.
Yep. Or whoever BU or possibly Cam coaching BU.
I don't see that happening, but yeah.
But yeah,
I guess I love Cam, but they usually hire BU guys.
Yeah, talking about coaches, that's another big one that's open. We haven't mentioned that yet, but that's probably, I don't know, maybe not worth the time. So that's, according to my count, in the next 2 years, there are 8 teams that are independent or looking for a conference that are planning to play D1.
You're counting Huntsville on that?
8? I'm counting Huntsville because...
So we've got Alaska, Arizona State, and Long Island that exist already, right? That played independent schedules this year.
Yes.
Right? We've got Anchorage coming back. We've got Lindenwood and Stonehill starting or joining D1 this year. And we've got Huntsville in limbo, and you've got Augustana coming the year after. That's what we've got right now.
That's what I have on my list. Yes. I don't know if I'm missing any. It seems like every week there's a new team that announces at this point. It's crazy.
Oh, Rob's back. Admit him. So we can talk about Huntsville. The big issue there that Huntsville took our money and used it to play 2 years ago and basically said, if we don't get in a conference, we're not going to play anymore. And they didn't get in a conference, so they're not playing anymore, as far as I can tell. But as I said to you before we started recording, like, that is no way to show your dedication to your program. And now that you've got, what, next year would be 6 other teams that have independent schedules.
I forgot one that we missed on the list. Robert Morris is back next year.
They are back, but they've already been admitted to Atlantic Hockey.
Yeah, so they're already in a conference, but they are back next year.
Yeah, they are back.
Speaking of back, hi.
Hi, Rob. We talked about you a little bit.
The entire house went dark. We were scared. And then it came back.
That's good. That just makes me want to come home this weekend and pick up my generator.
What's the first time we had a power outage in our house in a very long time? I'm trying to figure out when it was the last time we had one, but it's been a while.
I do need to find an electrician and get a quote on how much it'll actually cost to hook that up. Anyway, so Huntsville, like, I don't understand. Like, if you actually want to have a team, bring it back, because you've got six teams that are going to want to play, like, and at least at the end of the year. Like, you're going to get some home
to get players in the portal.
Yeah. Like, the portal should make it easier for Huntsville. I mean, look at what St. Thomas is doing. They're basically, they're losing, what, 7-8 guys? And they picked up a kid like Grant Doctor. Now, who knows how that'll work out? But, like, if the nice part about the portal is, I feel like when you do get stuck in a rut, you're not stuck there as long. Like, if you picked guys that don't belong in D1 hockey, you just cut them loose and go get new guys. Like, you can do that. You're not stuck with them like you were in the past.
Right.
And if Huntsville starts a team right now, like you said, they could go get 10 guys that have 1 year left.
Yep. They could jumpstart their team pretty quickly.
Like, you're telling me a kid like Terrell Buckley, if they had his masters, wouldn't have gone there?
Well, look what Lindenwood. Lindenwood's doing the same thing. They went and got, they're grabbing players. They're starting a new D1 team.
Yeah.
They got Salmon Kangas from Ferris committed there.
Yeah. No, I like goalie seems to be like the easiest thing now to do is you can get, like, it's not like Huntsville's going to have three freshman goalies if they come back. And like I said, like, one of the biggest problems that you have as an independent when you're the only one, like Arizona State was there for a while, is you don't have any games the last month of the season because all the conferences are playing everybody and that's it. Now, the Big Ten has seven now, so each one of them has a bye towards the end of the year. So you can get your games with them at the end, but then you've still got, you know, five other teams that aren't playing at the end of the year and they want to play you. Mm-hmm. Like, I wouldn't be surprised if Stonehill and Long Island save games for each other till the end, and try and get as many games with other Eastern teams earlier, but still, like, Huntsville's got a place in this current setup. If they put the effort in, and that's where I think they fail. It's not in, I just don't think there's enough want there, and that's why they're where they're at, because they want to be in a conference. Yeah. Well, show that you aren't a bottom feeder that's going to be 55th or lower in the pairwise. Like, show it. Show that you care. Show that you can invest in your program. Show that you can get all the cameras you need to meet the CCHA's video requirements. Don't take 5 years to do it. And just get it done and show that you care. Like, invest in the program and do it. And I just don't see it. I don't think it's going to happen. I think they're done.
Yeah.
And it's sad.
I agree. Unless we kind of talked about earlier before the podcast, unless somehow, some way, there is a split in Atlantic hockey where there's a whole new conference that is formed and they invite Huntsville, in which case Huntsville might still be a bottom feeder, but they'll come back if they have a spot in a conference.
Yeah. I am kind of surprised that Western and Omaha and, like, I guess I am shocked that UMD and St. Cloud and North Dakota and Denver, like, North Dakota and Denver make zero, like, that makes complete sense. But I am kind of surprised that UMD and St. Cloud have just stayed, like, in the top half of that, and that, like, Omaha and Western have too, that it's not like, I'm just surprised that Miami and CC haven't, like, cycled up more, you know, like had, like, Wisconsin type rises and falls within the conference yet. It just seems like they fall into the bottom and they're going to stay there. Whereas the everybody else seems to just be like, some teams don't fall all the way to fifth, but like, it seems like it's a pretty good battle between one through six every year.
We need to get games against CC. That'd be a great one to get games against.
Oh, I agree completely. We should be playing Miami and CC.
Miami's tough, though, because Miami has pre-existing rivals or local-ish teams that they like to get their non-conference games with.
Ohio State and
Bowling Green.
Notre Dame. And
right.
I guess, yeah, not too far.
CC is kind of out on an island with Denver and Air Force, and Denver's in their same conference. So CC is traveling for non-conference games. There's no reason why we can't get CC.
Well, I do think Denver and CC have done a lot of like the let's get BU and BC in here and yeah, alternate stuff. So that's harder to do, but we could get Denver and CC to do a split weekend with us and Marquette. And I can't understand why Patolny wouldn't want that. I'd like that. I'd love to have a weekend like that, but who knows if that'll ever happen. It sounds like we should have some news on the GLI here shortly.
Yeah, I think the writing's on the western wall there.
Yeah, I'm we'll find out soon. But it looks like the I don't know if there'll be any more games in Detroit, I guess is the way to put it, huh?
And if that's why they were there and what they were doing there, I mean.
Yeah, well, but I guess I don't know if it starts next year or the year after or what.
Sure.
Like when it's going to happen. But it sounds like, I don't know, because I guess we don't know what the teams are either. It'll be interesting to see, but maybe this will all be moot by the time you guys actually hear this, and I'll just delete this off the end of the podcast. But so, Dustin, did not make it in the podcast last time, right? Because we did that all after, where you actually predicted who our goalie pick would be, and then we didn't put it on the podcast. It was in the post show.
My glory was cut, or my glory was after the microphones got cut off.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see if. Well, we have it on good authority who one of the defensemen is. And from what I can tell, he looks like a hell of a player. And if any of you listening know who Matt Whaley is, he has a jersey for the team the kid plays for right now. Right? Doesn't he, Dustin?
I have no idea what kind of jerseys Matt Whaley has.
You recognize the picture in the host chat, right? I'm pretty sure he has a jersey for that team in Finland.
Okay. Well, I don't know. I guess if he does, I've never seen him wear it. But
I think he wore it to one of the St. Thomas games when I was up there, actually.
Okay.
It's a rather iconic Finnish team, isn't it? Aren't they kind of considered one of the best teams in
the world? Yeah, they are one of the better ones.
The professional level team is a junior team for that professional team.
Sure. Yes. I'm failing to make that distinction, but yes. So, yeah. I don't know. It'll be interesting to see when that news actually gets broken. I did everything I could to try and find proof of this from another source so that we could talk about it, but it's not official yet, so we have to wait a little longer. And maybe if this takes long enough, we'll do a little sub-segment and add it to this episode. But I think that's about it. Anything else you guys want to talk about?
No, I think that's a good wrap-up for the year there.
All right. We didn't really do like a team wrap up, but we got all summer to talk about that.
Yeah, we can do that. I want to.
If anybody out there listening is interested in buying a size 60 number 55 100th season jersey, please let me know, because the guy who said he wanted it keeps dragging his feet and can't seem to find a way to actually mail me a check. And I'm kind of getting tired of it. I sent him a request on PayPal for the money. So if that doesn't work, I think we're just going to, maybe we'll just auction it off or something. It's frustrating. I guess we can put a certain player's nameplate on there if you really want, since there's actually a kid wearing that number now. So let me know. Where's my outro? There we go.
1 minute remaining in the podcast.
Well, that should do it for this episode of the Chasing McNaughton podcast. Please check out our Patreon and join by visiting patreon.com/techhockeyguide. Thanks again to our two newest patrons, Brett Libby and Robert Carnahan. Did get a shoot. Where is that? I'm going to have to like undo this now, aren't I? Because we got one question. That was a legit one. And I forgot. Great editing, guys. This is gonna be fun at the end for me. Where is it here? Oh no. The other question was Marvin Wilson asking if we were gonna have any celebrity guests this week, Buchagrass, Melrose, or Starman, because he'd like to tell them a few things.
I think Starman likes you.
Biddy commented on something today on Twitter, and I couldn't see who was responding to him, and I thought it was Starman. I was like, wow. That's cool that he's got Starman responding to him. No, it was just somebody with a locked account.
Oh.
Anyway, back to the outro. Patrons at the white level or above get access to our quarterly Zoom chats with guests like John Scott, Joe Sean, Brad Patterson, Cam Ellsworth, and access to our Instat Heavy analytical articles coming this fall. Patrons at the black level or above receive access to extra podcast content, including extended versions of every podcast. And then we've got a couple different steps for fans that want to listen to the unfiltered YouTube video. That's the gold level. And then we've got a higher level if you want to help support the podcast even more. Check it out at patreon.com/techhockeyguide. Follow us on Twitter at ChasingMacPod and at Tech Hockey Guide. You can submit questions through Twitter, Facebook, or in our Patreon page. I think we got a new review. Somebody actually reached out saying that he was having trouble figuring out how to submit a review. But he did give us a rating at least, so that's good. Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on Apple, Google, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcast. If you can't find the podcast in your site of choice, please let us know and we'll make it happen. Once again, thanks to our sponsors, Fibke Dental in Rhinelander, Wisconsin, and Livonia Technical Services. Special thanks to Mitch Lake for recording our introduction and our patron saint, Dr. Fibke, for his generous donation to get this thing running. We hope you enjoy. Finally, thanks to the Thank You Notes for all the bumpers in this week's episode. If you like what you hear, check them out at thethankyounotes.bandcamp.com.
I'm going to make a pit stop to that Fibke Dental on my way up to Houghton in a few weeks here.
Are you?
I don't have an appointment, but I'm going to stop by the sign and take a picture by the sign just to say I've been there.
Nice. We're going to have to make it like a running attraction or something.
It's in Rhinelander, right?
Yeah.
You've been listening to the Chasing McNaughton podcast, presented by Tech Hockey Guide, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the CCHA.